into our new year of 2015-16. My name is Cindy Gorshi Coleman. I'm Vice President of the Sterling Society. We have several other Sterling members here. Eleanor Vassell is our co-president, and our Fred Newman. Coral Packer is sitting outside, coming to me, and she's a little short about. And let's see, Sheila is here. And then we have our new chairman of this coffee conversation, is Linda W. Masick. I'm not saying her mom name, but it's really long, honestly.
It's Wimmer House Masick.
Child,
with responsibilities of an adult. By 7, I was picking up my sister, who was 6 months old. I bathed her, fed her, and made dinner. By the time my parents came home, dinner was ready, and I was 7. But then I would go to school, and I was with the Canadian kids. And I was flamboyant, and I was very creative. And so I felt like I lived a very double life, a bit double life. I also felt a lot of responsibility. I was the firstborn, so as my parents sponsored all their siblings, I became the translator for everybody. I taught them how to balance checkbooks. I taught them how to read their mail. I would go to all the doctor's offices with them. So I feel like I didn't have much of a childhood, and my creativity was my escape. My creativity was not encouraged. It was actually discouraged because they had such a strong work ethic, and they valued financial stability, and they felt that anything creative would hinder that. And I'm still trying to prove them wrong. So by the age of 7, I knew that all that I loved was just going to be a hobby, and I actually did a lot of it on the down low. I would latch on to the Canadian kids whose parents valued extracurricular activities, and they would take me. And I expressed myself through painting, singing, dancing all throughout college, and fashion. My greatest passion was fashion, and it's understandable because I was raised in Montreal. Montreal is the fashion capital of Canada. It is also, in my mind, a European city in the middle of North America. There is no melting pot. Every culture is very well nurtured, and there's no melting pot. So, as early as I can remember, fashion was very prominent in my mind to the point where it irritated my parents. People still tell me stories where at 5 years old, I would have a fit that chose the wrong bow or the wrong outfit. And my mom was a seamstress, and so we were not well off, so she made a lot of my outfits, and I would draw for her. But, like I said, early on I was told that that's something that I needed to quench. So I early on decided that I needed to honor my parents' wishes, and I needed to come up with a career plan that was acceptable to them. So at that time, as a girl, what was it? Nurse, secretary, and teacher. So I decided to be a nurse. And I was very focused. Very focused. I had my life mapped out. By the age I was 12, I had my life mapped out to 32. Very driven, I had blinders on. And I look back and I regret it because I missed out on a lot of unique experiences because it didn't fit neatly in the plan. So fast forward. I go to college. I go to a very prestigious college in Montreal, a very rigorous nursing program, where it's technically a 3-year program, but you really can't do it because you're in the hospital 3 days a week, so I can fit in the other 6 classes. So I didn't take any breaks. Worked right through summer, right through Christmas, and I was one of the youngest graduates. And about 6 months before I graduated, I had to have an evaluation, which was a very regular thing. The evaluations were always very stressful because it was very subjective. This is your clinical instructor. You can have a 90 average and you can still fail. But this particular evaluation, I wasn't nervous. The teacher that was going to do it, I felt a connection with. She was very dynamic, very creative. She would teach in such a way that it would be instilled in your brain. For example, she was teaching us respiratory diseases in children. So she would read an excerpt from the Thornbirds. Remember that book? Well, we all got it right, because she's reading and describing this young child dying of croup. So this woman was very dynamic, we had a connection, so I breezed into the evaluation. I had 6 months to go before I graduated. And she sat me down and she says, I'd like you to consider dropping off. So she had a quirky sense of humor, so I said, that left. She's like, no, I'm serious. I think you should go to fashion design school. So for about 2 seconds, I felt very flattered because I was known for that. I was the best dressed in high school, and I looked very different from all the other nursing students. So I kind of thought of it as a joke, and then she said it very seriously again. And I remember the rage that I felt. Like, how could you be telling me this 6 months before I graduated? But I did it. I graduated, and then 6 months of graduation, I was in charge of the trauma unit in in Montreal at the ripe old age of 20. The classic story, met a man, got married, moved to the States, had children, quit a girl. Fast forward to 6 years ago. I had a 12-year-old daughter. Cute little thing, very introverted, very cerebral. My husband and I are very concerned about her. She doesn't seem to be living in the present. She just reads. There's no social life. She lives in a bubble. So my husband and I are very concerned. My son is the opposite. Athletic, very active social life, very popular. So we forced her to go into acting and modeling classes. And I was very shocked to know that she has a little switch in the back of her neck. That when a camera or light shines on her, she becomes this alter ego. She becomes this diva. So we encouraged it. And as the mom of a minor model, I had to go to all her photo shoots and fashion shows, and I would sit there for 10, 12 hours. And that's how it all started. Me being from the medical business, because I'm a nurse, and then I became a drug rep, and now my husband and I have a medical business, I'm used to a very black and white, dry environment. Expectations are clear, everything's written out, it's a contract, and deadlines are not a suggestion. Now I'm in this environment with all these creative people, these dynamic, flamboyant people. I was so enthralled by the whole thing. But, like I said, sometimes creativity comes at the expense of other attributes. People would call in sick and not show up. And I'm just sitting there, so I would pitch in. And slowly but surely, I became more active in the fashion world. And I started being asked to be a concept director, which means that I would have to choose the location, the concept, the models, the hair, the makeup, the designer, everything, and come up with these elaborate concepts. And I did 3 or 4, and I really enjoyed it. And that's how it all started. This is the last concept shoot that I did. I asked a very talented designer to provide 2 dresses. And through no fault of his own, he could only provide one a week before. I was desperate. This was just 3 of the 6 models, and it was outside shoot. We had ladders, oh gosh. I didn't want to cancel it. I put so much work in it. So I asked him, listen, can I make a dress that has the same theme, but I'll make it different enough that it's not a replication of yours, and I'll put the credit so that no one can mistake that it's yours. And he was very generous and said yes. So I purposely made the picture so that the focus was on his, and then I made mine there. But I have other pictures, and the feedback that I got was so positive and so wonderful that it was a very critical point, and it came at such an important part of my life. When I did this shoot, I was feeling lost. I felt like I defined myself only through what I can provide for other people. So I was my husband's business partner, I was my husband's housekeeper, I was my husband's secretary and social coordinator, my son's dugout mom, my daughter's mom, but who was I? I was lost, and I was very bitter about it. When I started getting positive feedback from that dress, and people started asking me to make more, I felt very selfish, but I owned it. This was nothing to do with my family or anybody, it was me. So it came a very critical part of my life. So after that dress, I got asked to do fashion traction. So this dress is made out of chicken wire, biohazard, body fluids, the biohazard bags, hot scrubbers, and blood vacuum. And I didn't win the contest. It was like over 70 entries, but I was the only one that made it on the newspaper. And I knew that I had found a new lease on life. And I started getting people asking me to make specific gowns. And I was through the roof. I was just not happy. And this was my first, I call it official commission piece. This is from the Museum of Fine Arts. The artists were asked to pick out a piece from the collection. And this was the piece that was my inspiration. Now, I'm not a typical artist. I didn't do this from the beginning, and sometimes it's just not that complicated for me. It just isn't. When I look at art, I'm not drawn to a specific genre or even, you know, time. To me, it's very personal. It either speaks to me in one of two ways. It either evokes emotion or a memory. So it could be something abstract, or it could be a period piece. Now this one, at the risk of making myself sound shallow, this just made me think of a blue jelly bean. That it was as simple as that, and I thought, okay, I'm gonna make a dress out of blue jelly beans. And that's what I did. So this is made, this is all jelly beans, and then this is papier mâché.
What did you say?
What is the
bottom of the
papier-mâché.
Yeah, sorry, that's the French in me. So that brings me to the Dunedin Fine Arts Center. About 6 months after that, I went to the first Wearable art show that I saw. It was 4 years ago, and I went to support two designers and a few of the art models that I knew. And I'll never forget that night. I was wearing the most hottest shoes. They were so hot, but they were so uncomfortable. And I had standing room only. And I didn't even notice I had blisters until I got home. And I've used this word before, and I will use it again. The experience was magical. It was just magical. The feeling, the air, the art, the fashion, it was just magical. And I decided right there and then that I was going to apply next year. But I also knew that I couldn't just pop one outfit here and one outfit there. I needed to be cohesive. I needed to make a collection. So 2 weeks after that show, I had my collection bought out. And I slowly but surely did it throughout the year. And this is the bridal collection. It's my first cohesive collection. And it's made out of paper doilies, cotton balls, tree branches, and gauze leaves. And it's called Something More. That was a pivotal event. The media attention associated with this event is crazy. Because of that, because of the Dunedin Fine Arts Center, I got asked to do Brooklyn Fashion Week, Atlantic City, and Philadelphia, and all kinds of other ones, but I only did three. For Atlantic City, I opened for Michael Kors, Alina Castillo, and Dom Streeter, which are the budget runway winners. And I was nervous about that. I thought, oh God, they're gonna think, oh, here's some middle-aged, midlife crisis girl from Podunk, Florida. But they treated me really well. They treated me like an equal, it was great. And then I closed Brooklyn Fashion Week. So because of Dunedin, I went straight from Dunedin to New York. And that's me closing the show in New York with my daughter wearing trash bags. So I always joke around with Ken and Georgianne that one day I will dress Lady Gaga. And Katy Perry, because I saw that what's that tournament for football? What's it called?
The Super Bowl.
The Super Bowl. Put it in a care package, and I sent it to my dad. And
And he calls me up, and he calls me up and he's like, I have a confession to make. I'm like, what? He's like, I looked over your box of stuff and it's nice. Nice is a very good word. I mean, I almost fell off my chair. Nice, oh my God! And he says, well, I have a confession to make. You know, I'm not getting any younger and I need to die with a clear conscience. I'm like, oh, okay, well, he says, well, I had three separate secret meetings with your teachers throughout elementary school, high school, and college, and they all asked me to put you in design school. And I kept it a secret from you. For the first minute, maybe, let's say 5 minutes, I literally felt my blood boiling in my ears. I was so angry. But then as quickly as it came, it went away. Because this is a man with a very good education, who did the best that he could. And I'm college educated, my husband's college educated, and we've made mistakes with our children. We've made decisions that we questioned afterwards, even though it was based out of concern and love. So I forgave him, and I just told my dad, well, you know what? It was meant to be, because if I had done the art thing in the beginning, I wouldn't have met my husband in medical school, and I wouldn't have had my children. So it's all a good thing. But I don't really think my dad got it until 3 months ago. My father is very old school, no risk of money. He puts his money in a safety box, and he renews it every year. So he goes to his bank, the same bank for 28 years, and it's always the same conversation, how are your daughters? So this specific time, they asked specifically about me. How's your daughter in Florida? Is your daughter in college yet? I said, yeah, she's leaving. Well, what's she up to? So my dad says, oh, she dabbles in fashion for her free time. Makes her happy, what are you gonna do? Maybe she's going through a midlife crisis, we don't know. So she says to him, well, Mr. Teixeira, like, can you show me some pictures? He says, I don't have any pictures. She says, well, what's her name again? And my father gives her my business card because he uses it as my phone number, like my phone is a and so she Googles it and all these pictures come up. And she's like, Mr. Teixeira, do you know that your daughter's well known? And he's like, what do you mean? So he says to me, Lina, this is his answer. Lina, do you know that the internet knows about you? I said, yeah. He goes, I don't understand, he says. Why does Mr. Google know all this? So I think he finally got it. Okay, so now this is the time where you guys get involved. I want you to guess what these dresses are made of. So let's start off with the one on the left. I'll give you a hint. This was my daughter's junior prom dress. There was a little kerfuffle at the lunch table. Somebody threw an apple at the lunch and it splattered all over the dress. So it's completely ruined. I tried to clean it twice, can't get it out. So I modified it. Can anybody tell me what these are? And the back, because the back of the dress is completely ruined.
Is it wallpaper?
Paper napkins.
Oh.
Yeah. I paid a lot for that dress, but she didn't want me to design it. And this one, I'll give you a hint. 8 kids did it for me. All the neighborhood kids did it for me.
Crop tops.
No?
Which one was she talking about?
This one.
Oh, that one.
This part right here.
This one. Beer? No, no.
Rough.
You know those little elastic bracelets?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
It took 6 months for 6 kids to do it.
Oh.
Like over 100 feet.
What's the bottom?
The bottom is just tulle. I want to tell you, about 75% of my dresses are upscale, I call them. I buy them damaged, I buy them completely torn to shreds, and then I fix them. To me, it's more challenging to come up, to have an original garment and decide what to take away, what to add, and to fix it. I do things from scratch, don't get me wrong, but for me, my passion is to buy a vintage dress or a destroyed dress and fix it and change it. Because it's fun. What do I take away? What do I add? How do I fix the stain? Do I cut it off? Do I cover it? So, I do want to say that.
this from his
sponges.
Luba sponges.
Yeah.
Here's something that I didn't know.
Oh.
That one Luba sponge weighs nothing, but 300 Luba sponges. Did you know that if you handle coffee beans, you can't sleep?
because when I have trusted some people, they don't show up, they're late, they don't, you know what I mean? So I control everything, everything. However, I have met a group in the last 3 months that I'm slowly letting go and actually letting the guy style it for me. It's just one less thing for me. Like, he'll be like, okay, let's put this jewelry with him, let's, you know, let's try to do the hair. I mean, I still always have the final say, but it's kind of nice to let go and say, okay, Tristan, this is the look I'm going for, show me what you got. Versus me searching for hours for an image to show the hairstylist what to do, and another one for the makeup and stuff. But, yeah. I like my mom, she's like a broken clock. She's right twice a day. And she's always right about things that she shouldn't be right about, and she always says to me, when God gives you a gift, it's at the expense of something else. It's very old school, and I don't believe half the stuff she says, but sometimes it rings true. And, you know, when you have a lot of creativity, it comes at the expense of something else. And a lot of creative people have a hard time with time management, and you know what I mean? And it gives me heart palpitations to count on someone that's going to show up 2 hours late. Ugh, I can't handle it. So I like to control everything, but I'm letting go. I'm letting go.
How many shows do you do a year?
It depends. Really, I'm going to stop doing fashion shows for about a year. Because they're so expensive. Like, flying my dresses out to New York cost me almost $1,000, just one way. Because one dress is just one box. Can't fold it. I get so jealous of the other designers who just hold the suitcase. I have like 10 boxes that I have to ship, get to the hotel before, bring the boxes to the show, open them up, and then, you know what I mean? So I have to be very strategic. Because I'm at a point right now where I'm very blessed with the media attention that I have.
Yeah.
And now I need to make money. And I can't just keep spending all this money to get publicity and then not get any return. I mean, it was kind of creepy, actually. About 4 months ago, I bought a skirt on eBay. I needed a vintage skirt, and I wanted it out of velvet. And I wanted it out of nice velvet. And I priced it out, the materials and everything was going to cost me, like, I don't know, $65. And I went through eBay trying to get it back for my son. I got bored with it, so I started looking at it, and I find a white vintage skirt for $10, exactly the same. So I bought it, because it's hard for me to spend a lot of money on the base when I'm going to destroy it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, why am I going to make the dress from scratch when I'm going to cover it in screws? And it's so expensive too, you know, the zipper and the findings, and it's just easier to get something vintage. So anyway, the woman answers me back, oh, she's from Virginia, never been there. She says, oh, I'm going to thank you for purchasing my skirt. I'm going to send it to you tomorrow. And by the way, are you the Lina Teixeira, the Wearable artist?
What?
Are you, she's asking, are you Lina Teixeira, the Wearable artist? Somebody from Virginia. That was kind of cute.
Yeah.
And then I went to Home Depot in St. Pete. Never been to Home Depot in St. Pete. Never. And but I was there because I had an exhibit, which still has another 6 weeks if you guys want to see. I have an exhibit at the Florida Craft Center. There for 6 more weeks. So I was preparing that because that opened the night before Wearable Art. I never knew that. So I was there and I needed some supplies for the Dunedin show. I went to the Home Depot in St. And I asked for somebody to help me unroll AstroTurf, but I only needed 1 foot. So the first guy says to me, 1 foot, who needs and the birds. So this year when I did Wearable Art, it
was a very conscious decision to do my collection as very couture, very refined, not over the top, and to really use all the weird materials very subliminally. Of course, that decision was made before I found out that I was closing the show, so I was kind of stressed out about that, but that one took a long time to be that restrained and to have it all done so that it was true to the country that they're representing, because I did Mundo, which is different.
Oh, well.
Yeah, and so I kind of did it tongue-in-cheek. So Canada was about to release, but she was sexy as hell with her boots sticking out. I don't know if you saw it. And then UK was a plastic bag. So the rehearsal time was rough because I spliced the music in such a way that I knew who was going to need a heavy beat to do the marching and who needed a softer beat to do the dancing. So the rehearsals themselves took 2 days. Yeah. So this is what I'm talking about. This is Canada. Believe you me, Mountain Police do not look like that. As my many relatives from Canada let me know. So it depends. And I do it in stages. I don't just sit, I do a lot of 3 garments at a time. Because I get really irritated doing the same thing over again. Like this collar is made out of bathroom mat. And a bathroom mat. You know those fuzzy ones?
Yeah.
So I have to pull each one out and sew one each on. It's flipping tedious. And that's when I do my binge walking and watching Netflix. Like now I'm on season 4 of Sons of Anarchy because I just have to keep, you know. So what I'll do is I'll do an hour of this and then I'll paint a mask and then I'll paint this and then I'll go back to that. So I have 3 pieces. So I never really keep track of how long it takes. Yeah.
First and foremost, I'd like to apologize to you and everyone for being late.
No worries.
Secondly, if you like your carpet taken apart, just call me. My dog will be more than happy. Thirdly, because I have a collection that I've kept doing something as well. I know you have a book, but does it represent the whole collection? And if not, will you be putting one together?
I have a book. It's not about me, though. The book was before. The book was right after the fashion concepts I was doing. I was tired of doing all these photo shoots with my daughter, and the pictures never got anywhere. Or no, let me rephrase that. I was tired of doing photo shoots where the creativity had to be quelled to meet the requirements of the client. Do you understand? We would get these great images, but it didn't really show off the outfit really well. It didn't show off the shoes really well. So the creativity was always under control. So I came up with an idea, this is a crazy world, to just locally have a book that would be published with all the photographers and makeup artists and all the models. They would submit their pictures. There was no criteria. The only criteria was there had to be no religious message, no social, and it was not convention. It had to be controversy-free. And so I got a huge response, and the next thing you know, Facebook, I don't know how it happened, I actually got submissions from Africa, Portugal, Greece, Italy, France, Sweden, Croatia, and Vietnam. And it's all in the book. And there was no concept, it was just submissions from artists. And it was called Dimash. And I still have a few copies of that.
Do you have any with you?
No.
And then I want to thank you for the lovely items that I purchased. Everyone compliments me, and I've always given you a Christmas card. So, bless you, coming right on my heart, but I need a pair of shoes that are 7 inches to wear one of the skirts.
I
have ears, I have 6 and a half.
You need to check out Ivanka Scott. That's the shoes my daughter wears. My daughter's only 5'3". So when she does a runway, she wears 8.5 inches.
Wow.
And she nails it. I thought, did any of you guys watch the show this year? Wearable Art? My daughter was USA. She was the last girl up there. If you saw her, she was mole. And she was wearing 8.5 inch shoes. I hate when she does that though, because I'm watching guys stage and I'm like, why do you have to go there? Like, it'll make me scared, but whatever. Yeah.
What is the most difficult material that you work with, and what would be the most fun one that you have?
Okay, the most difficult one was I did this gown for Art Alliance of St. Pete. And this is what I do a lot of. People give me their logos or people give me their concepts, and then I make gowns to auction off for fundraising. And I've been so blessed. They're usually in the top 5% of the return on investment. You know what I mean? I mean, they actually do better than the trips. So this gown, I only charge the charity my materials and half my time. So I sold the dress for like, what, $300? And they made $1,450. Yeah, it was great. And but they asked me, they're like, okay, well, we're featuring this painter. This is the image, what can you do with it? Well, I had a bright idea of printing the picture in this laminated paper and shredding it and then reassembling it. Did you know that it's flipping hard to reassemble it? I figured, how hard can it be? It's one paper. The bin was empty. Oh, I was flipped. So what I had to do is I had to cut the paper to four and shred one section at a time and then reassemble it, and then with an exact knife, cut it so that it would fit into the dress.
Oh,
that was the hardest. I would never do that again.
Wow.
Never. And the funnest one is something that I've been doing lately, which is hand painting it. So I painted US, I painted France. So hand painting the garments is fun for me.
I mean, if someone wanted you to do a dress that was very dramatic or something like that, would you do it, or is it more fun and more, your ideas are more to be more collective and different?
Oh no, I'm very versatile. Usually what happens with my private consultations, they come in, I close the door, and I ask them, what do they want? And I give it to them. As simple as that. As simple as that. The client's always right. Even if I don't agree. You know what I mean? I do the Sueños of Dali. You ever heard of that? The Sueños of Dali? The Dali Museum has a humongous fundraiser. I mean, humongous. VIP, like $600 a ticket. And I dress most of the guild there, and it's in October. And I've had clients who are, you know, I had a client 66 years old, and I guided her to what I felt she would like. She would have none of it. She's like, no, I want something more spectacular. That's what she wants. And I'm like, well, what do you want? And she points to a picture of my daughter wearing a see-through lace dress with wings out to here, two feathers here, and a feather there. And I said to her, okay. I said, would you like to have a slip underneath? She says, yes. I said, okay. I try it on. She's happy, I'm happy. She turns around, she goes, but my ass looks too flat. You need to add something on there. So I did. I put a nice big floppy tail. So it is not up to me to tell my clients what to wear.
But do you enjoy doing that as much?
Oh yes. I love collaborating. I love to merge the ideas, you know. And I'm very flexible. Like, I always start off the conversation with, what do you have in mind and what's your budget? I never say no. If their budget's tiny, then I can figure something out. If their budget's bigger, then, you know what I mean, I never say, oh no, it's gonna cost you this. You tell me the budget, I'll make it work. Yes.
Where is your salon in downtown Clearwater?
It's on Cleveland Street. It's right across the street from Station Square and the Sun, what is that building?
Sun Jersey.
Yeah, right there. By the way, I have nothing else better to do, but I'm organizing a 3-block party October 30th. It's going to be a band in every block and a DJ across the park. I'm having a fashion show there. It's going to be a masquerade theme. There's a simulator truck, there's street performers, and the Capitol Theater just agreed to show Rocky Horror.
Can you speak up a little bit for the
party? What part did you want me to say? I'm organizing a 3-block party in downtown Clearwater.
Oh, very nice.
With a band in every block and a lot of stuff.
Well,
October 30th.
What day is that?
That's a
Friday.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Friday. Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
If you were to drop by your studio today, what would you see there?
Well, okay. Most of my dramatic stuff is either in storage or at the museums, different museums around the nation. But in my window, I have my ready-to-wear collection, which I just started this year. I take regular clothing, and I implement recyclables. So the normal person can wear. So like I'll have a dress, a black dress, and just a cap with sleeves, and the design on the front is made out of plastic grocery bags. Or recycled pillowcases. Or recycled floral arrangements. But you can wear it. And I also have a new collection of hand-painted bustiers and men's vests. Yeah, so my window right now is pretty regular. It's just ready to wear because I need people to know that I do have regular clothes with a regular person. But my boutique is not open every day. I'm there almost every day, but it's not open. Because a lot of people that come in from the street, they just want the AC and they just don't want that. You know, I have a very specific clientele. My clientele just calls me and says, hey, what are you doing? I'm like, what do you want? You can be there in an hour, and I go there in an hour. I give a lot of one-on-one attention.
Mm-hmm. What's the name of the shop?
Studio 617. I share it with a photographer.
Did you bring your business cards?
Yeah.
Maybe I missed. Do you make for men?
I'm starting to.
Hold on a second.
Yes, I've made a couple of vests made out of videotape, and I do hand painting.
Can we go take a tour?
Sorry?
Can we go take a tour?
Yes.
It's amazing. It's truly amazing.
Yes. If you guys, I can organize it with Ken, and maybe we can have a formal tour.
It's beautiful.
What do you think about that? I'm sorry, I didn't feel prepared. Any other questions?
trip on your shoes.
Did you have a website?
Yes. It's just myname.com. I'm trying to find an intern to manage my social media. After the wearable art party, the fashion show, I went to sleep at 4 in the morning because my phone was worn out. And then woke up at 6 and I had 187 notifications, 48 messages in 4 hours. So I need help. And my Instagram and my Twitter, I can't stand it. So I need help. So if anybody knows of an intern, let me know. Anybody else?
Thank you.